The fact that the production meddled with the film and that Fincher didn't have final cut. My biggest issue is that Fincher had never read the novel.
Lynch.
Fuck. Fuck. I'm sorry. I just, David Fincher is my baby. Let's rewind. So I think that's the first time that you correct me. Oh my God.
They are not even similar.
I know.
Don't know how you did it. Well, hello there, my dear sir, madam. Welcome to this lovely, if I may so say so myself, episode of Films and Fika. The podcast where we talk about movies, have some fancy, lovely coffee, tea. What are you drinking there, my good sir? And also known as my co-host, Mauricio.
Hey, Algo, what's up? I think you were really selling that bit. Congratulations.
Was I going too hard again?
No, I think we've gone harder, for sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, because I've been there. Didn't seem that hard.
How are you? I'm good.
I'm good. I'm cool. I'm mellow, I guess. Yeah, nothing is going on. There's nothing new from last week, I guess. It's been another week that just passed by. That's all I can say.
Yeah, I get that.
Yeah.
I think most of the people can understand that feeling where it's like, oh, I thought 300 fucking years have gone by. Apparently it's been 2 days. Mm. Welcome to my life.
No, to me, more recently it's been more like 2 days feels like 2 hours.
No shit.
You wake up, you do shit, and then you go back to sleep. I was like, what happened? What happened?
Oh, I wish it could be that way for me. It just feels eternal at this point. I'm not going to lie. The beginning of the year is always weird.
Oh, yeah.
It always feels really, really long.
Mm.
It's like January, February, March, and then suddenly, out of nowhere, it's July.
Yeah.
And then, you know, holidays start happening. Halloween, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and then it's New Year's Eve, and you're like, oh shit.
And like the complete opposite of the beginning of the year would be those days between Christmas and New Year's where time just exists. You just exist.
Yeah.
But I guess that's the thing. Springtime is just, I don't know about you, but springtime is almost full on here, and it seems early.
Here too. Like, we went from being significantly colder than other years to now it's hot as balls.
Damn. Climate change, man.
It was really weird, I'm not going to lie. And usually, I don't like spring because it's probably the hottest time of the year here.
Hottest.
Because summer is rain season for us.
Mm-hmm.
So then I enjoy that. I'm okay with that.
Yep.
But fucking, which actually is funny because it comes... that little factoid will come back when we talk about the movie that we're discussing this week, which is Dune, the 1985 version. 1985, I believe.
84.
I might be wrong. 1984, directed by David Lynch. I think we have things to say about the movie, to say the least.
Yep. And I think it should be mentioned, like, if it's not clear enough already, of course, we were highly excited for Denis Villeneuve's version that was supposed to be released around this time, but I guess we're gonna have to wait a little bit longer. But we couldn't wait to watch the original version. Is he making a full up remake? It's more of a, what would you call the new one?
No, like, I think
it's sort of a sequel, like, but it's sort of a new take on the universe. It's,
he's doing like his own whole thing.
Yeah.
Which is, I was very excited for, but then after this,
I know, right?
I'm more worried than excited now. Because the original idea was for you and I to make like a double feature episode where we watch both of them. Which I was thinking about it for our next episode or one of the next episodes. We could do that for Suspiria, which is a movie that you and I have spoken about doing an episode on before. Point is, I was excited. Denis Villeneuve was coming out with this movie. It's a sci-fi. He's been wanting to do it for so long. So I read the book last year, loved it. And then no movie came out.
Yeah.
Sad. So then we settled and we watched this. But more on that later, I guess.
Yeah, we'll see how long it takes until we review Denis' movie. Mm-hmm. Hopefully not too long. I don't know. I have a kind of high hope still. He made Blade Runner, right? So can't be.
Oh yeah.
Can't be that.
No, I think he has the better. Yeah. Like, he has really good potential. I think, out of anyone else who could be doing it right now. But I don't know if that's enough.
Yeah, exactly. I hear you there. That after seeing this, it's a bit. I don't know anymore.
Yeah. It killed something inside me. Yes. I'm not gonna lie.
But I don't know. They claim that it's gonna be more closer adapted to the novel than this Lynch version is. So,
I think it's an interesting topic in itself. You know, like, what makes a good adaptation? You know, like, if we talk about novels, everyone's first thought is Harry Potter.
Yep.
Right. Obviously, because they're fucking huge.
I mean, I've never been one to read books, so I would never be able to be that one to claim that the book is better than the movie. I think I did read 2001 before I saw the movie. Nevertheless.
I think you're the first person that I've ever met who's like, I totally read 2001 before I saw the movie, man.
Kubrick's
a dumbass.
It was for a school assignment. I would never have read that book. But yes, of course, the book is better than the movie. And I feel like that's known. If you're going to complain about the book being better than the movie, go right ahead. It's not a surprise to anyone. And you're better off watching the movie first and then reading the book, I feel, because then you're gonna go in with high expectations for a good movie, be fulfilled, and then read a book and be happily ever after. I find you should just do it in the right order.
I don't know. I've personally never been able to read the book after I've seen the movie, especially because, like, the big plot points are usually there. I don't know. I also feel like when it comes to adaptations, if you look at the different ways of doing it, Stanley Kubrick is probably the most famous one for not giving a flying fuck about the actual, like, fidelity to the source material. He really just kind of always used the bare bones of the book and made the everything else his own. Like, that's why people either love or hate The Shining.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people don't understand that it's Stanley Kubrick's The Shining, not Stephen King's, you know?
And do you think there is a right or wrong? Should you respect the original content more than Kubrick does?
I think it depends on who you are as a filmmaker and what you want to bring into the table. Because here's the thing, right? I feel Kubrick, specifically with The Shining, which is probably the only movie of his that I can talk on this topic about, because I've never really read the rest of the novels. He changed things, but he also had things to say instead of those things that he left out. You know, so sure, he took out some of the themes, he took out some of the plot, but he also added to it what he wanted to say, you know, what he thought was important to him. And I feel when you're making a movie, you need to care about what you're trying to say, or at least know that you have something that you're trying to say. whether it's an adaptation or not. That's like the most important part of it.
I think there are just so many layers when it comes to novels. Like The Hobbit is another infamous version of adaptations where they took one book and made three movies out of it in the same sense.
Which was dumb.
Yeah.
Like that was just a money grab.
Oh yeah. No question about it.
And like an insanely stupid one. The book is 200 pages long, man. Like,
but I guess it was like Peter going in there and looking to expand, making it his own, but it kind of backfired, I guess, because the original trilogy was closer to its original content. I feel like you gotta meet expectations, and that's something that Dune definitely fails to. Like, it's odd. The audience of the book, in this case, is not at all as close or the same to as the people who would go to see the movie. Someone who reads Harry Potter can easily see the movie. I think Hunger Games is another example of that.
Yeah, for sure.
But definitely someone like David Lynch and Kubrick is, I guess, a little bit more whack of a director. So naturally they would go more outside of the box or the frames that are painted. And I don't know. If it's marketed correctly, like, not necessarily marketed as from the novel by yada yada, then then it should work fine. But it can easily be misleading.
Yeah. The other thing is, like, even nowadays, if you're adapting a novel, you're for sure going to use that as part of your marketing.
True.
Right? Because the appeal of adapting a novel, especially a novel that is well known as was The Shining or The Hunger Games, or in this case Dune, is that you have like a big piece of your audience is already a certainty, right? Like you can be sure that the people who read the book are most likely 100% gonna go watch the movie.
Yeah.
So then why would you try and alienate those people by showing it in the trailer that you actually didn't respect the book, you know?
And then I don't know if you feel like we should save more of conversation for the actual movie talk, but for Dune, it's like one book and trying to jam. Obviously, a book is more fleshed out. It has more character and more descriptive thingies. And the thing that this movie fails in is that it's trying to have so many, or it's expand, not expand, but it's trying to include all of the things and cram it into 2 hours, which of a book that is so long. Opposite of The Hobbit, naturally. But I feel like I just am anti the culture of making trilogies. So I appreciate the effort, kind of, in making one standalone movie. But maybe just take a chapter and make a fully well-developed movie out of that. The chapter might be a little bit too little. But, you know, you can chop up a book well enough and make a movie and be hopeful about making a sequel, even though I don't think you should have any plans making a sequel unless you get the green light and your studio is Marvel. But
yeah, that's too true.
I mean, I'm just tired of trilogies mostly. First of all, why are trilogies a thing and not just sequels? There should be such a thing as just a sequel, because that's a good amount. A double feature to me is a good marathon to have. A trilogy marathon is okay, but it takes up a bigger portion of the day than two features does.
I mean, what was the last two, like, duology that you saw in movies, though?
There is none, is there?
I don't even know. I don't think so.
You got things like Twilight that have... Is it a quadrology or is it a penta? No, it's quad, I think.
Twilight is 5 movies.
Oh, really?
So yeah, because there's 4 books.
So that's a pen. The last one. Pentology. Like,
I don't know what the fucking name of
it is. It's Greek, man.
I don't know. It's like it came out right around the time when splitting the last movie became a fucking trend.
Yes. Yeah, Hunger right. Hunger
Games did it. Harry Potter did it. These guys did it.
And honestly, I think Harry Potter justifies it. But not Twilight. I never saw them, but I bet. I kind of want to have a Twilight marathon just that, like I had a Hunger Games marathon, just to know that they're not worth it. But I need to watch them just to know that.
I liked the Hunger Games, the first two.
Yes, the first two are great. The first one is honestly really nice. Mm. But if you compare the aesthetics of the first one and the second one, completely different tone.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's insane. 100%. And it, like, but it's weird. I will say this, though. I like the second one better. I also like the second book better. I think they're both better.
I don't like example, the second one because it ends on a huge cliffhanger, and I don't like that. I just don't like sequel...
Yeah. I mean, that's fair. Mentality. That's fair. Okay. I think we've dawdled enough in different topics and tangents. We can get into our recommendations for the week, Algod. What have you seen lately that you would like to give us?
To give you? I can't really give it to you physically. Yeah, yeah. But you could look it up yourself if you have a Netflix subscription. I've seen recently, and I'm not sure if we have recommended on this podcast before. We might have, and I apologize. I'm not sorry. Love, Death, and Robots, Netflix. David Fincher? No, wait, what? Fincher? It was Fincher, right?
I think he executive produced it. Yeah.
Yeah, right. He produced all of it. But they are short films. On Netflix, they appear as a show or whatever. But I went home to my dear friend. Shout out to you, Olaf. And he's a history buff and all. I think he's currently reading about Russian Cold War and stuff and everything. And I'm like, oh, we need some background noise while we eat. I got the thing for you. And we put on... So I put on the last episode, the 18th episode. Watch all of them, of course. But my absolute favorite, hands down, the best short film out of all of them is The Secret War. Elite units of the Red Army fight an unholy evil deep in the ancient forests of Siberia. It's beautifully animated. It's amazingly performed. It's just, it's what's the Scott Pilgrim quote? He says, "Music to my ear holes." So it's more like it's cocaine to my eyeballs, right? It's fair. Gorgeous, and the concept is amazing. The again, the acting is amazing. The visuals are amazing. I need a feature length movie of this short film. That's how good it is. It's my absolute favorite out of all of them. Again, watch all of them if you haven't seen a single one. But that's...
They're watch all this. Beautifully animated. It's insane.
Mm-hmm. The Secret War is one of those very realistic... Must have taken them forever to render that shit, but it's impressive. Again, another short film. Another short film. We should watch more of those. Go ahead and again, Netflix, you probably have it. Watch it.
Mm-hmm. God, it's so good. I remember when it came out and you and I just fucking fanboyed the fuck out of that.
I don't know how many times you've rewatched them, but they hold up. They're so good. I think I've seen all of them like 3 times at least, more than my favorite ones, definitely more.
My recommendation of the week is also sci-fi.
Ooh.
It's on the lower end of sci-fi. It's a time travel movie. It's a comedy. It's a rom-com, obviously, because I fucking love those. And I don't know if I've recommended it before, but hey, guys, it's been a fucking week. It's been a rough week. I needed some comfort. I needed a warm hug. And I wanted to know if this movie was going to hold up multiple viewings, and apparently it does, because I still love it and I still think it's super good and it still made me laugh, and it's called Palm Springs. It's a 2020 movie distributed by Hulu, so I'm not gonna lie, I streamed it illegally, sorry. That's not my fault, though. Like, you don't want me to fucking pirate your shit, make it available for everyone, goddammit. Yeah. It's a 2020 movie. It's directed by Max Barbacow, and it stars Andy Samberg of Brooklyn Nine-Nine, The Lonely Island fame, and Kristen Milioti, who you know, was the mom in How I Met Your Mother, and then that show went to shit. But it's so good to see her back and see that she's so, like, she's so funny, man. Like, she is so funny. And it also stars J.K. Simmons, who's kind of, like, in everything now. Like, in small roles, but in everything.
Indie stuff? Sure.
Yeah. Good for J.K. Simmons. It's amazing. It's about a time loop. It's, like, existential enough for you to be like, man, this was me during quarantine. So, you know, you might have a bit of a flashback there.
Aye.
But it's dope. I think it's really, really funny. I think you should check it out. If you need to know where, you can DM me. And I will not share the link with you because that is illegal, guys. But DM me anyways.
He is winking on the video screen. By the way, you should totally watch this on YouTube. On YouTube, we like edit this shit and we put in like trailers and the thingy. That's why we always get copyright struck, but we don't care because it's fuck the system. We want you more invested in watching our faces. No, actually, we don't want you to watch our faces that much. That's why we do it.
Mm.
I don't know. You recommended something Hulu. I recommended something Netflix. I have a question for you.
Yeah.
If you were, how do I phrase this?
Yeah.
If you, in with your knowledge of streaming services today,
yeah,
had to pick one streaming service, and for the rest of your life, you would have it for free, let's say, cool?
Okay.
For the rest of your life.
Yeah.
But you can only pick one streaming service, Netflix, Hulu, Amazon, whatever you'd like.
Yeah.
But you have to go down in a monogamous relationship with one streaming service for the rest of your life. With your knowledge of where they're heading, which one would you pick?
Where am I living? Am I living in Mexico or am I living in the United States?
I mean, you can use a VPN if you really want to, just like everyone else.
Maybe I'm using the wrong VPNs because mine don't... Fuck! Anyways.
I don't know. Let's put you in America, sure. If
I'm in America, just because of where it's headed this year and because it's the most expensive one, I would use HBO Max.
HBO.
Yeah.
I never understood. Sure. What's the difference between HBO and HBO Max? HBO is the Game of Thrones, right?
Yes.
And Max is movies.
HBO is like, you know, HBO Max will be like their online streaming platform. And HBO is just like the normal TV version of it.
Oh, okay. TV service.
Mm-hmm.
And no doubt about it. You're really... Is it just because of all of the
licenses? I mean, all licenses? Of the movies that they're going to have there, that's insane. Honestly, Dune. Like, fuck. They have Friends there, which, you know, it's like a comfort thing. It's a comfort thing that you go back to when you don't know what else to stream. And they just have like a lot of good movies and they have some really good shows. So it would probably be that or Netflix for sure.
Huh. Interesting. Because I feel like maybe it's just because I'm kind of anti them as a company, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure if that would be such a long-term wise decision of you. Of course they have Dune coming up in the coming year, and they had, didn't they have Wonder Woman, speaking of it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, it's James Bond. Fuck.
Yeah.
I don't even know what licenses they have.
Like, here's the thing, it's like, realistically, the way that this is going, I might just stick around for a year.
Yeah, man. But that would also mean that you wouldn't get to see the next Pixar movie, possibly as soon as it got released, if they are ever going to come back to theaters. Who knows? There will be some exclusives online. You won't be able to see the next season of Stranger Things.
I would be okay if we didn't get another Stranger Things season.
No, yeah, absolutely.
That's how uninterested I am with it now. Anyways,
Dune.
We can move into Dune.
Let's head over to the 1984s.
All right. I will give you guys the low, the down low of the movie.
And then it's only up from there. No.
Yeah. No. Okay. Dune is a 1984 movie adaptation of the novel by Frank Herbert. The novel is considered one of, if not the best sci-fi book franchise novel. Dune specifically, the first one, is pretty much loved by everyone. And it's directed by David Lynch. This would be his third feature. So he did Eraserhead and then The Elephant Man, and then he went on to do this.
Oh.
It stars Kyle MacLachlan.
MacLachlan.
I don't know if that's how you pronounce it, but we're going to go with it. As Paul Atreides, he's the main character. This is also his feature film debut, and the start of a beautiful relationship that him and David Lynch developed through the years. And I think he got better and better. This is definitely not my favorite performance of him by a long shot. It also stars Francesca Annis, Patrick Stewart, Linda Hunt, and Jose Ferrer, and a bunch of other people, I'm not gonna lie. Kenneth McMillan, and so on and so forth. The music, though,
whoa,
the score, is written and performed by Toto.
Toto. There is one track that it's done by someone else who's actually popular, yeah. I think. But Toto did the heavy work.
Which was insane to see.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was like, Africa?
Right? Damn. It was like, are we going to hear some blessed rains in the Africa here? But no, he never sings. He's literally a composer. And not bad of a track. Pretty good.
You know, like, I feel this was right around the time where Danny Elfman was also trying to be a composer, and he was like a rock musician first, and then Tim Burton was like, hey man, I want to do the music for my movies and be amazing and basically define a generation of music composing, and he said yes.
And I guess that he is kind of unpredictable as a composer, but Toto, though, he's not very cinematic, I guess. I don't even know, man,
like, everything about this movie is weird to me. Like, really looking into why and how the movie was made, weird. So weird. Especially when you think about the other versions of the movie that could have existed. Ridley Scott was supposed to do this after he made Alien. And then Alejandro Jodorowsky, who's a Chilean filmmaker, was also supposed to make a version of this with, like, Salvador Dali and a whole bunch of other people. It's weird. It has a weird history. It has a weird product, like, final product. In terms of, like, my 5-minute spoiler-free review, would I recommend this movie? If you have read the novel and you're interested in seeing David Lynch's interpretation of it,
okay,
go for it.
Really?
Other than that, don't watch this.
Wait, actually, because I to my understanding, he's deviating so much from the novel, as we've spoken before, of that they are not a fan of it, or is it just interesting to see? Is that your point?
I think watching this, knowing that he deviates so much from the source material, is interesting in the way that watching The Shining is interesting for people who read the book first. Don't go in with high hopes or expectations of the actual plot or characters. I'm not gonna shit on the movie for the next 45 minutes because I'm trying to be better. So I don't want to shit on it for 45 minutes. Because there's also some really good things about it. Like, I think there's some salvageable aspects of the movie. And we can talk about those too. But in terms of, like, recommending the movie, I wouldn't. The only reason why I sat through the 2 hours was because, A, I was obligated in order to do this podcast, and B, because I understood it enough because I'd read the novel before.
That probably helps you, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Other than that, the movie's just like a weird amalgamation of the highlights of the novel. And the highlights are great. I love the highlights of the novel, but they make no sense together. Like, there's a reason why there's a whole narrative between these movies. Honestly, it kind of felt like a Zack Snyder film, where it's like, it's just moments.
Yeah. So, yes or no, would you recommend the novel as its own?
Oh, yeah. Dude, the novel? Here's the thing. The novel is the perfect balance between the... It's very... For me, as someone who was, you know, I didn't read it when I was younger, and I had written others. I had read other stuff before this. For me, Dune captured kind of brilliantly what Game of Thrones managed to do with fantasy. Where Game of Thrones has such a heavy political side and such a heavy, like, who's who moment, but also fucking dragons and White Walkers and all that shit.
Yeah.
So it's a really nice balance. I think Dune does that really, really well too, where it's like this whole universe of politics and intrigue and like suspense and betrayal, but also really cool sci-fi concepts.
Yeah.
And the themes that it touches upon, which is also why people hate on this film, because Lynch kind of took the themes and wiped his ass with it. they're so interesting in the sense of like this idea that you're the chosen one. So it takes the trope of being the chosen one and being a hero, and it makes it kind of one of the main conflicts, internal conflicts for the character of Paul, where he's like, what does it mean to be the chosen one? And the responsibility of being adorated by a bunch of people. And I thought it was really cool. So the novel, yes, read it. It's 900 pages of awesome. I loved it. This was sad. It was sad to sit through, I'm not going to lie. So I wouldn't recommend the film, no.
Nor would I. Some thoughts about it is basically... I mean, I guess I knew the basic premise. Sand planet, dunes, sci-fi-ish atmosphere. But to my understanding, Dune is like a looked up to movie and everything. I guess my expectations were higher. And it has nothing to do with the aspects of the fact that it's a very much a product of its own time, being a sci-fi movie in its 80s. And it's Lynch. It's Lynch. You can't expect that much, but you could at least expect a slightly more well put together story. And there are explanations.
Especially when you take into consideration that some of his best work was done after this film. Like Blue Velvet, Mulholland Drive, Twin Peaks, the movie for Twin Peaks. Like, he went on to do great shit. And he did good shit before.
And there are a lot of studio interference as an explanation to that. But I can't recommend it. It's not a good watch. And it's kind of lowered my hopes for the Villeneuve version of it, honestly.
Yeah.
I thought this was gonna be a way more solid flick, but no, it's it's pretty bad, and you can spare yourself watching it.
We watched it so you wouldn't have to, please.
I guess. But yes, there are some good parts, but I do not promise that I will not shit on it, because I will.
I'll probably break and do it too, but with that, we'll get into the spoilers now, because there's a lot of them, and, you know, we'll jump around the movie. There's no need for us to go from beginning to end, because if you think about it, the movie's such a fucking mess in terms of storytelling that even if we tried going from beginning to end, it would make no damn sense. So, yikes, huh?
Yeah, pretty much. But but I will say, did you really struggle to get through it? Because that's not really true. But what kept me going was basically the concept. The familiar environment of sandworms and just rebellion against the system. I don't know. There was something concept-wise that kept me invested. to see where it was going. Very unsatisfactory of an ending and progress towards it. But I was bored, but I stayed put because it's cool. The world is interesting and they're trying a lot of things that ultimately fails completely. But it's cool. It could be the next Star Wars, by all means. Could have been.
Yes. Well, here's the thing, right? We both know that with the movie, they were like the producers. Every producer that this movie had, even before it was properly made by David Lynch, thought of Dune as the perfect answer for Star Wars, right? Like an adult version of it.
Yeah.
And here's the biggest reason why I struggled to sit through this movie. I already knew what was going to happen.
And right.
That shouldn't be an issue, though, right? Because we knew what was going to happen in Harry Potter. We knew what was going to happen before we saw Hunger Games. Like, people knew what was going to happen, but the interest was still there.
Yeah.
Right? Because you care about the characters. You want to know about the characters. You want to see the adaptation of it. My issue with the movie is that at some point I realized that what they were doing is like a highlight reel of the biggest moments of the novel. But the thing is, the biggest moments of the novel pay off because of what's going on around them, right? The context of them. And also, most, like, half of these highlight moments in the novel are heavy, like, action-heavy sequences that were kind of impossible to make with 80s technology.
Do you think that's a drawback, though? Because I never had that much of an issue when it comes to the CGI and whatnot. I think it holds up.
I think the only thing that didn't hold up for me were the... Well, and here's the thing about the action sequences themselves, and I think my biggest issue with the movie... David Lynch didn't have Final Cut. Production meddled with the film and with the final product a lot, and... But even with all those things, my biggest issue is that Lynch had never read the novel before. And as we've seen with successful adaptations, and even...
But how did
No, for sure. Like, for example, Cuarón had never read Harry Potter, right? But the screenwriter, the person who was like actively creating the bare bones of the film experience... had, and he was like deeply familiar with what the film had to be. So when Cuarón comes on board to direct Prisoner of Azkaban, not only did he read the book and made his research, but he also had the sensibilities on his prior films to understand what the characters were doing.
Yeah.
Right? Like, a lot of people think, huh, it's kind of weird. The movie he did before is like a road trip coming of age film that's kind of like very sexual and like very this or that. How does that apply? Like, why choose him for Prisoner of Azkaban? But it makes perfect sense because Prisoner of Azkaban is like the point where the series turns into a teenager as well. It's like the coming of age of the franchise. In terms of Lynch, he had made some really good stuff, but he wasn't necessarily the obvious choice. And then they give him 6 months to read the book, which is a behemoth that deals with so many things, and then adapt it into a screenplay that's 2 hours long.
Yeah.
That's fucking impossible, man.
Yeah, like, through and through, they're not setting it up well for him, and they're meddling with him at the end of it, if not even throughout too. So he's never giving the creative freedom, as he very much have expressed himself and complained about, that David Lynch needs, because it's David Lynch. I guess it was earlier in his career, so they wouldn't respect that. But we know now that, you know, he's a whack job, and if he just would have gotten the the his own rights to do whatever he needed to would have been a better piece. We know that for a fact, I guess. I find it hilarious the fact that Universal have approached him multiple times in trying to persuade him into making a new cut, and he's like,
no,
cold hand, no,
no,
no.
Especially because he hated what they did with the final product so much, he asked the Directors Guild of America to take off his name. Like, there's versions of this movie where he's not credited as a director.
Yeah.
Actively. Or the screenwriter.
If that's not a big middle finger to them, I don't know what is.
Yeah. Let's talk about what works. Because I feel like a lot of people have a lot of issues with this movie. So before we shat on it, we shit on it, I think we should probably talk about what works. I do like some of the wackiness that comes from a David Lynch sci-fi and B, a 1984 sci-fi. The scope of it, the sets, the like the production design,
the costume, the even makeup. Makeup, totally. Like my best way to describe it is the atmosphere that it creates. It has such a potential with what it has, what's on screen. There's such a potential with that, and it flops with the rest that needs to carry it. The concept is cool, man. I feel like it's kind of. It feels kind of, I don't know if that's in the novel necessarily, but there's a lot of things that could be interpreted as the Force from Star Wars. It plays out in the same sort of way, but it works. The magic aspect.
Dune, because Dune is one of like the biggest books of sci-fi, and it came out pretty early in the sci-fi genre as we know it now. It shaped a lot of sci-fi properties that we love nowadays. One of them being Star Wars. So yes, for sure, there's like areas of it that remind us of different franchises. But the rest of it doesn't work, man. Like, the editing is rough. The performances are yowza. Because I forgot to mention that we one of the cast members is Sting of Police.
So I think, if I remember it correctly, and I'm gonna remember it this way because it makes for a way better story. It's not really a story. What am I talking about? Basically, when Sting comes up on screen, I'm like, whoa. Who's that guy? I know that guy. But he's in this weird ass hairdo.
Yeah.
In this super strange outfit. And I'm not even talking about the speedo kind of situation that we see later. But his face is just so recognizable. And I didn't think much of it because honestly, he's not that much in the movie until the credits roll up and like, Sting? That's Sting? And he has some very cool facial expressions and stuff here and there. Mm-hmm. And that's what he does. Amazing.
Dude, can we talk about the speedo moment though?
Yeah. You gotta give it to him. That chest, can't say no to that.
Dude, it also comes like at such a random point in the movie. And it's also just one of the most, like, it's burned into my brain, you know? Like, you get no context for it. He's just like there in full display of goddamn.
And what is the scene? He speaks to the other guy, minion type of deal. And then he goes over to Sting and is like, yo, Sting, what's up? I don't think Sting says a single thing during that scene. He's like, yeah, go kill some dudes, okay? And he's like, yeah. He just makes expressions.
For me, the villain, Baron Harkonnen, is probably one of the worst parts of this movie. Is that because
of his performance, though, or
yeah.
You know, the character? Yeah.
The character, everything about it is just so, why? Why? Like, because in the book, he is kind of menacing. Like, he does have a bit of a goofy flair to him. Like, he's a villain kind of thing. But there's also very dark moments with him. Like, the book alludes to him being kind of like a pedophile, and he likes taking some of the younger people on his staff, and like he does things to them, not only sexually but otherwise. And you kind of get a little bit of that at the beginning when you first meet him.
Yeah, he just pulls the heart plug out of one random employee, it seems like.
And also, like, we never get like, okay,
why they
it's have. one thing to not explain stuff in sci-fi, and we talked about it last week in Frequency, where it's like, we don't need to know how it's able to happen. We don't need to know why they can talk 30 years difference. But I mean, some things, like... we don't even know what the fuck it is. We know it's a heart pump because at some point in the movie they mention it as a heart pump. But I guess it's a cool character design. I don't know.
It's like something all Harkarians has it. And now you have one too. Cool. Okay.
Yeah. All right.
It's a kill switch. That's what it is. It's a kill switch.
And then convenience. It's like, he, in the book, he is supposedly so morbidly fat that he needs to float around.
That's why.
Yeah.
I was just about to comment on it because he just floats around like a balloon.
But in this one, it's like he's A, not necessarily morbidly fat. And B, the way that he floats around, I get that it's because he's on wires. I get it. But also, why does he randomly just like float up and then he comes back down, and then he's so cartoony in this whole, that's that scene where he supposedly is in ecstasy because he almost died.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just sitting there and he's like, I'm alive. And then he starts floating up. I'm like, I'm sorry, Harry Potter did it better.
I guess you're right. But I feel like all of the performances are so... It's not their fault, ultimately. I think it's more of a script or dialogue reason.
Cheesy.
Yeah. The way people are just going around pulling lines. One of the first scenes is of the... I don't know what he is. The guy who's approaching in the ship and is docking. For some reason, he says something, drinks some liquid. We never get that explained, but that was a whole thing. Like, what was that? Out of all of the things that they had to cut out for this movie and flesh out, apparently, because it was supposed to be a 3-hour, 4-hour long movie, they decided to keep the most random things.
Yeah. Like, and things make no sense. Things make no sense. Like, I fucking... Oh, my God. Okay. One of the things that I think this movie is a good example of what not to do is voiceover narration. Yeah. Wow.
But again...
It is so bad.
But if I understand it, it is directly a reason because of studio interference, and it was like, well, we have to cut it down, so now you have to make things clearer for the audience. But no.
And the reason behind the voiceover narration is why I'm mostly worried about the Villeneuve adaptation now, because reading the book. I'm reading the book, and I was listening to an audiobook because long books scare me. They're very intimidating. So if the book is longer than like 500 pages, I read it along with the audiobook. And the Dune audiobook is really good. Like, it's like produced and it has like different voices for the characters, and it's like it has ambient noise. Like, it's really dope.
Those are nice.
And, you know, I was like, damn, like, this is gonna be hard to really adapt because there's so many inner monologue from all the characters. They all have they constantly think about things, and then you add this idea that certain people can communicate telepathically with some others. So I was like, man, that's kind of hard to nail. But, you know, every book out there has inner monologue from the character. And, you know, other filmmakers have been able to adapt that and kind of like show and not tell.
Yeah.
This is all tell. And it's really bad telling.
Yeah.
Like, can we talk about why is the voiceover whisper? Why is it whispering? Right. Do people whisper in their heads? Yeah. Like, is it like,
of course.
Oh, man, that's a really good bowl of cereal I'm about to have. I cannot wait to enjoy this.
No, you see, it adds mystery or like, there's probably a good explanation to it. Just probably for aesthetic reasons, but it doesn't work. Of course not. But all that the voiceover, all that the thoughts that we hear do is exposition. There is once, like, Paul, the main character, is in this ship, and the first time he has direct contact with Spice, by the way, why it's called Spice? we get an inner dialogue of, like, Spice, pure, raw Spice. I mean, yeah, we can see... You don't need to. Oh my, come on. Isn't that such a textbook thing not to do? On the screen is thoughts.
And like weird thoughts, right? Like it's weird, not like, because it's, they're supposed to be information dumps, right? They're supposed to give us context as to whatever is happening, but they're bad dumps.
And there's one thing with the very first scene when we were first introduced to some characters being telepathic and all. That's one thing, hearing their voices in their heads and all. Mm-hmm. I can get with that. Or even when they communicate. I don't think they communicate with each other directly. Maybe sometime.
Just at the end when Paul does it with
his sister.
His sister.
That's fine. But the rest of it? There's you give us nothing with the thoughts that we hear. Nothing.
Like when he meets Chaney and she goes, tell me about your world, Usul. And we had heard that line because he dreams of it. Mm. But apparently we're not smart enough to remember that he dreamed of it because the movie's so fucking messy that of course you forgot that line when, like, at the beginning of the movie. So we hear Paul repeat it to himself. The same line we just heard. He repeats it to himself and he goes, the dream takes life. And I'm like, oh my God. Oh my God.
No, that's just, it doesn't make sense to me that you had to remove so much flesh from the movie that you now have to introduce voiceover. And the voiceover that we have is just so bad.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make sense to me. And there is one thing in the case for Star Wars when they go to the editing room and they realize that, like, well, the first scene of this movie is kind of weird and we don't really know where we are. So we're going to have to add a text crawl, right?
Mm-hmm.
In this movie, their version of it is from some weird lady in the space fading in and out into blackness. And she's just giving the basic pitch, not even of the universe that we're in, more of political situation.
Political situation that A, never gets explained, and B, that is so not ever a thing again in the movie. Because in the book it comes back, right? In the book it's a constant, like, oh, the Harkonnens and the Atreides, they don't like each other because of this, because of that, whatever. Sure. But in here it's like they set it up, they use it to set it up, the context of the film, but then they never talk about it again ever. And then because they fucking crammed 3 to 4 hours of a movie into two, a lot of the character interactions make no sense at all. Where it's like, we're supposed to understand that the person who betrays the Atreides has a reason, but the reason is never really properly explained.
No.
And it's just like, because of his wife? I think.
Is that a reason?
Well, and that's what I mean, right? Because in the books, he thinks his wife is alive, and that's why he does it, right? But in here, he's already convinced that his wife is dead. So then what the fuck is the point?
To me, it was that the Arcanians, I already forget their names. It was like them hacking his programming or indoctrination something.
Yeah.
That's why he has the symbol on his head, and there was some explanation to it, like he's loyal to the throne, or I guess not a throne in this case, and all of that. But for somehow they manipulated him. That was the explanation that I understood. Probably no right or wrong in this case.
Wow.
There was no motivation there.
And then, like...
We get the lady here in the very beginning. She does mention the fact that spice is... it's the one thing that you need for space travel. That's all that we get explained throughout the movie. Mm-hmm. That spice is necessary for space travel. Why? I don't know. It seems to be just some space dust.
It's whatever. Sure. There's no stakes.
Exactly. But you might have just as well introduced, if you're going to do it that expositionally, you might as well do it when we did the first scene with Paul and he's literally studying up on this desert planet and we get some weird, this is how we mine for space dust. Just do it then if you have to do it that up in your face. The movie is just filled with unnecessary explanation to the audience because they apparently think we are stupid, and just expositional things that which are explained.
Rough. And like, I understand Dune is not super accessible. You know, like the book is similar to Game of Thrones in that it has a glossary in the back where it's like, these are the characters, these are the terms you have to know, all that stuff. Star Wars was like, this is a blaster and this is the Force and welcome to the movie. You know, like, I get it. I get that it's not an easy thing to do. Well, but it just pisses me off, man.
It puts you in a place where you're part of the universe in Star Wars, different from Dune, where you're an observer, or rather, you're studying it. You're being told what happened as if it were a history book.
Yeah, it's very dense, and it's like, I guess the voiceover was supposed to tell us what's going on, but it doesn't, because the only thing it does is use these terms that we're not familiar with and assume that we would know. Like, apparently, rumor is, and I'm not sure because A, we weren't alive, and B, I didn't research it enough. But apparently, I heard that they gave out like a pamphlet with the keywords that you needed to know right before you went into the movie.
Jesus.
And like, already by that, people would be turned the fuck off, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. The more we talk about it, the more afraid I'm about Denis Villeneuve's adaptation. He's been doing so good, man. Like, he's on a really good train right now.
But I can see it being a difficult thing to adapt. However, I can get with that, and I understand that the process with making this movie was effed up. There was a lot of things going on, and it was not easy for the director or anyone else. But it's not an excuse for this.
I think this is a good example of something we saw with like the last Star Wars movie that came out, Episode 9, where it's like people who don't truly understand what needs to happen in the movie try and make the movie. And I'm not talking about J.J. Abrams, although he is partly at fault, I'm not going to lie. I'm talking about producers. Producers who are in it just for the cash grab, right? The reason why they gave Lynch 6 months to figure this script out was because the rights were about to be up for grabs again. They needed to start making the movie because otherwise they were going to lose the rights for it. And that should be a fire sign. Not gonna lie. And then, you know, like, to Lynch's credit, he has owned up to the fact that he was selling out. He was selling out. When they asked him to make this movie, he thought this would, you know, allow him to explore his creativity with a budget that he's never had this big of a budget after this. Like, he's worked in smaller budgets. And, you know, some filmmakers need that. Some filmmakers need to kind of pull back. I'm sorry to bring this back. People are going to think I'm a fanboy. But basically, I was watching this video on Nolan and how his movies have been getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And that it would be really interesting to see what he makes with a smaller budget again. A smaller budget like he did with The Prestige or with Memento. Arguably some of his best work, you know? So I think Lynch just got caught up in this whirlwind of like, dude, I have $40 million, of which they basically didn't make it back. I think the box office for this was 30. Mm-hmm. Making it one of the biggest flops in movie history.
One of the biggest, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Especially of like that time.
And they had really difficult issues. I think it was the guy, Frank Herbert, who wrote the novel or somebody who was included in the process of the screenplay somehow said that it was just weird because it missed its target audience. It didn't know what target audience it had. The target audience of the novel was not the same as for the movie. Mm-mm. The producers produced a movie and marketed it for some complete different audience. So the marketing was just a fail by its own.
It was weird. And if you think about it, the movie itself just doesn't speak to anything that the book did.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Like, it doesn't, like, Paul never doubts that he's the chosen one. He just accepts it. Like, mm-hmm. everyone else in movies, he's just like, yeah, fuck yeah, I'm the chosen one. I'm a badass. And then it never really talks about why spice is important. Spice is important, and it's supposed to be like similar to how we give value to certain things in society that don't necessarily are that valuable. Like, there's just a lot of things that David Lynch omitted, I guess. Like, also the weird design that he chose, like in the Dune universe, there's no robots. Mm-hmm. Because supposedly robots became so advanced that we had a war with them that we barely managed to win. Cool. So we decided never to make robots again. So that's why there's no robots. Mm. But then there's robots in the movie. Also, technology is so advanced in the book, like protection wise, like the shields that they use are so advanced that long range weapons like blasters are not a thing. So like hand to hand combat is the way to fight, and it gives to so many cool moments. Yeah. And in here they have guns.
It's that such a cool,
work with your thoughts.
It's such a cool idea to just rid of guns. And originally we're gonna have some martial arts in this movie, which is dope. It could be so cool of like hand-to-hand combat, and the stakes are higher and it's more intimate and wow. But no, they just shoot each other for most of it. We have one climactic with quotation marks. It's not climactic at all of a knife fight,
and it makes no sense either. Like, he pulls out, like, we see that Sting has like a poisoned blade coming out of his armor.
Yeah, what was that?
That is supposed to, I don't know if that was supposed to hurt Paul. Like, what the fuck?
It seemed like an illegal move that he just had a hidden blade in his, I don't even know if it was his belly area or a knee
and blade. Then he never uses it.
No. Literally, the blade is poking out towards Paul. And Paul just decides to flip Sting on top of him in order to avoid the blade. That doesn't make sense. And then he sticks his knife into it and he's fine. Doesn't make sense.
Also, just the way that it ends with the rain.
Yeah, I heard about me that. Off. That pissed you off?
Yeah. Paul's not God.
Yeah.
Paul is he's a metaphor for every single hero in like media. Mm. He's like the antithesis of that because he's not God. He is skilled and he does have certain abilities, but they're not unique to him. But he's just really.
But in this movie, he is God.
In this movie, he's straight. He made it rain.
Yeah.
And we don't even know why.
No.
It's just like.
They have a big water reserve below ground. They're most likely fine.
And like. In the movie, we understand that it's important that there's no rain on Arrakis. Yeah. And that's why, like, water is such a fucking big part of it. And you know, this is coming, like, it was a missed opportunity, if you ask me, to make social commentary on the fact that, you know, we're killing the planet and we're doing all of this. And you know that I don't care about that type of stuff, Alga. You know that I'm not, like, the activist in the sense, but talk about a missed opportunity. And then, yeah. Like, you get this whole context of why water is important and why filtering, things that we find normal nowadays are so weird. Then, like, the people on Arrakis, the freemen, they don't cry, because if you cry, you're losing water. So when something heavy happens, like you lose somebody and you cry for them, it's like this whole ritual of, like, you giving up basically something that helps you live and sustain life. Your own life.
Cool.
For someone who was important to you. And that's why, you know, they want to change the face of Arrakis, because they found out a way to, like, get water and possibly change the whole geology of the planet so that it's not a desert anymore.
That's cool.
And, like, it's super cool, but I also understand why it's not part of the movie, because it's also really dense. Like, it's the denser side of the science of the sci-fi.
Yeah.
But then why fucking include it at all?
But it would be so much stronger of a piece if they just would have picked that up, focused on that 100, even 90%. Get rid of the love interest, for fuck's sake.
Which is, like, it's so weird.
It's just there, and he falls in love with her at first.
It's so bad. It's like, it's probably one of the worst examples of instant love.
Yeah.
In any medium.
I think he literally says, the girl from my dream. What the fuck?
What the fuck? And, like, okay, man. Like, there's a lot of different movies that do this type of stuff, because, you know, it's a movie. Like, you know, instant love happens to some people in movies. Mm-hmm. But Twilight made a better sense of it. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Like, at least in Twilight, it was like, oh my God, it's a fucking vampire and he's hot as hell. Oh, you wow. know? Like, here it's just like, I saw you in my dreams.
Yeah.
And then he literally says to himself, so beautiful. And I was like, fuck you. Fuck you for not even, like, also, Chaney is supposed to be a fucking badass. Like, she is skilled. She's a great warrior. She's super smart. She keeps Paul from making some really fucked up mistakes. And in here, she's just like, I will love you forever. Baby, never. Don't leave me.
I think
this movie.
The first scene we see her in is literally that. I mean, she's like, oh, the girl, she's so beautiful. The second scene we see her, I think they're making out. And he just walks up to her.
Also,
and they just make out.
Weird make out.
Yeah?
It's very awkward.
I didn't think of it.
Well, it makes me think of the credits. Because the credits are kind of the same in their editing, where it's like there's a background and they're like fading in and out of existence.
Very green screeny, old school. Yeah.
Yeah. Dude, those credits though. I mean, they're like,
they're cool, aren't they?
They're cheesy as hell though.
Yeah.
And they kind of like sum up the whole movie, which I guess is a good job on their part, but it's like the amount of cheesiness, like even the soundtrack, it gets weird and like kind of TV infomercial.
Oh yeah,
I'm so sorry for David.
I feel
Lynch.
Like that's just product of its own time. I think those kind of things can be excused.
I mean, the thing is, there's a difference between cheese, which is what we got in Frequency last week, where it's like, okay, this is cheesy, but it's, you know, it's cute, it's kind of warm, you know, like it's a father-son dynamic, it's cute, to where this is like, why? Like, it's borderline cringy. It's borderline cringy.
I don't even feel like it's cringe. It's just straight up bad. right? It's because I didn't expect it to pass the Bechdel test. Not at all. The first
Which
10
is sad,
minutes...
because the novel does.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
No, I bet it does. I mean, the first 10 minutes tell you exactly what you're up for. And I will tell you, I was sort of invested for the extent of the movie. But I will tell you that halfway through the movie, when officially, what are the bad guys called?
The Harkonnens.
Yeah. Those guys attack. They take it over. And we, Paul and his mother, have to escape out into the desert. That's when it just bombs for me. Like, up to that point, you got me. It's kind of cool. And then, predictably enough, they are introduced to the natives and yada yada. We have some water. Cool. And then time just speeds up for some reason. I'm sad.
It's exactly what you said. It's like the movie starts off and it's fine and you're kind of following it. And then they get betrayed. And after they get betrayed, it's like, boom, speed ramp. Mm-hmm. This is what's happening now. It's not good.
What I do appreciate is the sandworms. The fact that he's just climbing sandworms and he's riding the sandworm around. Or do they just call them worms, I guess?
Sandworms. I think it's going to look really cool nowadays. I think they can make those scenes justice.
I was never bothered by the half stop motion, half practice miniatures and stuff. I think it was passable.
I think most of it was past the only part where I was like, ugh, that's kind of sad. It's where he like stabs one of them and he like gets carried on top of it. And it's just like a wide shot of tiny Kyle MacLachlan going up this weird thing.
No, I didn't think of it. That doesn't ring a bell to me.
Exactly. That's how forgettable it was.
If I were to criticize the special effects, the CGI, and all that good jazz, it would be the bigger action scenes when people are shooting blasters, even though blasters are apparently
not
a thing. Shouldn't be a thing, rather. They're only bothered to... Some shots are without special effects. They're just shooting in thin air and stuff.
I do really
appreciate the small, like, assassin-looking thingy that comes out and he's just standing still and he will not move and he won't see. And that's kind of cool of a thing.
I think in terms of, like, the practical effects.
Yeah.
In terms of the practical effects, my biggest issue is just the shields. Like, we get to see them and they're, like, these Minecraft kind of thing. I was like, no. No, I unsubscribe. This is
I like the shields. I think the shields are cool. I mean, yeah, they're blocky to compared to today's standard. It's fine, but considering Tron came out 2 years before.
Fair.
That's cool. They have to sit down and code these motherfuckers. Of course, they're not going to have perfect contours. And it's like transparent and see-through. And I feel like the effect is kind of cool. It looks super janky and stuff. But that's why it kind of fades away halfway through the knife battle. Knife fight.
You don't need to see these.
I enjoy the shields.
I like the way... I want to shout out the rotoscoping artists for this movie because
is it even called rotoscoping back then?
Yes, because they did it by hand, and they had to do it by hand. So basically, what they did for the blue eyes was manual rotoscoping, and that shit must have taken fucking days.
So they're doing like multiple exposures to shine some light through.
They had to do it manually, frame by frame, paint them.
Oh, they're adding in. Okay. Yeah, and there's a lot of blue eyes.
Yeah.
Honestly, considering it's 84, there's a lot of special effects. I didn't expect that. It's a lot of blaster fire. Yes, the shields look janky AF. the spaceships holds up pretty good.
I kind of dig it though. I like the spaceships.
Yeah.
In terms of production design, I think that's the thing that holds up the most.
Yeah. Everything aesthetic wise, I think costume should be highlighted as one of those things that are just good.
I like the Fremen suits. The other stuff, like the Harkonnen and the Atreides outfits,
I guess
they're weird. Like the first time that we see Paul and he's wearing this like colonel outfit, it just feels like it was tacked on. Like why?
Maybe. I think it's okay.
I like the Fremen outfits though. Those are really dope. Yeah. Like with the nostrils and
which I don't really get. Are they born in that environment and they just have to wear suits all the time? Are they human?
They're human. It's just like the Fremen suit, what it does is like they're nomads, so they live out in the desert for a really long time. Like long stretches of time. So what the suit does is it captures your sweat, filters it, and makes it drinkable water.
Oh, I thought it was just an air cool or water cooler.
No. I mean, it works like that too. But basically, sweat. And then you sweat, urine, and your breathing. That's why they exhale through their nose.
Yeah. That's what happened with the pee. I thought he just collected it.
Just a bag of pee for you.
Ah, jeepers.
Jeepers indeed.
But as per that, I think that's pretty much all that I enjoy about this film. Yeah, there's not much.
No, I'm sorry, Toto, but even your score was kind of meh.
Ooh, I didn't expect you to disagree with the score.
It was just okay.
Oof.
Like it's feel if you're gonna make a space epic, right? Like, at least make it memorable.
I guess there are climactic scenes where you could have, but I'm not sure if it's necessary. I'm not sure. But it's sad because the potential is so there. There's so much potential with this. Ultimately, would you have? I know the studio didn't like it, but if it would have been 3 hours long, do you think it would have been a better flick? Because this movie is suffering so bad from trying to push so much of a book into 2 hours. And the editing, honestly, to compromise is not that great.
I think they
could have, for my sake, they could have set it up to be to be an obvious sequel following up, and that would have been a better movie. Like, do whatever you did the first part and do that for 2 hours instead of continue with whatever that was.
Yeah. I feel the only proper way to make this movie is the way that Denis Villeneuve wants to make it, which is split the book in half.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, I don't know if it's going to make enough money for us to get a second half.
I'm not sure it will. No. So I hope it's a good first half. And then we'll see. Be happily surprised.
Hopefully. But yeah, no, the only way of making Dune into a movie is splitting it into two movies. I'm sorry. Like, there's just no way. And it's not, I don't think a TV show would be better. Like, I like the idea of it being two movies. Just like, because if you think about it, The Lord of the Rings was published as one book, right?
Yeah.
So technically they split one book into three movies. And it works perfectly, right? Because it makes sense. This needs that. This is like 900 pages of information, new information that should be at least a little bit explained, right? So split it into different movies and just be as faithful as to the book as you can. Because the book works for a reason, right? So find what makes the book work and then build upon that, which is probably why the new movies that are adapted from the It book by Stephen King. That's why they work, because they found out what the center, what the core of the movie is, and then ran with it instead of trying to be exactly word by word the book, or not taking the book into account. You know, that's the key to an adaptation, is finding what makes it tick, and then build on that.
Absolutely. And with that said, we both know that it's extremely, extremely difficult to adapt a book to a movie, especially this long of a book.
100%.
They're just so different mediums. So I'm astonished the fact that it works so well. I guess if you ask a bookworm, it's never as good as the book regardless, so you'll never satisfy those people.
I think the best adaptation I've ever seen is Gone Girl.
Is it close to the original?
I honestly like the movie better than the book.
Ooh. I guess murder mysteries or detective stories, for that matter, usually do well on both forms.
Think it's just like what I think the key part of Gone Girl is that the writer of the book, Gillian Flynn, was the screenwriter for the movie. So she got to pick what what made the book work and make it better for the movie.
I'm not sure that would work in many other situations, because it's a different art form of writing screenplays and books. I'm hopefully optimistic about Villeneuve's version. It can't be much worse. I mean, to my understanding, he's more interested in the original concept and all, and has gotten more time to spend on it too, right? So, he has the upside of things that Lynch didn't. So we've spoken a lot recently, you and I, about how we're now starting to see how studios, producers and stuff are letting directors and creators do a little bit more of their own on their own and not intervene. Dune 1984 is what happens when they intervene.
It's way a great movie.
So much.
It's a great movie to show people who want to make movies what not to do. Like, if you want to do voiceover, watch this. That's not how you do voiceover. If you want to start editing, watch this, and you will learn how to completely disjoint a narrative. It's insane. Like, the way that they jump from one scene to whatever. Basically, it's a good masterclass of a film to know what not to do. And I think it works as a really important piece of history as to studio meddling and what happens when studios don't give full creative control, don't give final cut, and just constantly try to make a movie for money.
Ultimately, it feels like we didn't touch much on the story and really break it down as usual. And yes, because we've been shitting on the movie a whole bunch. And I'm sorry.
There's no story.
There's no story. There's nothing good about it.
Like, we can't talk about we can talk about the movie story. We can't talk about the character development. We can't talk about the script, because it's a mess. Because it's all over the place. Right? Like, there's
It's just not comprehensible. It just doesn't make sense to anyone anyhow. It fails in most ways that you can fail at, unfortunately. I had hopes for it. I didn't think it was this bad. I guess I've never heard anyone criticize it at all.
Yeah. I thought it strange. I thought it was going to be okay. Like, I even heard some people think of this movie as a cult classic.
Yeah, exactly. It does have a cult following, even the movie. Of course, the novel, right when it came out and as such, were so huge. But the movie have a little bit of a following, surprisingly, unironically.
I don't know what they see, though. Like when with other cult movies, I'm like, oh yeah, I get like The Room, right? With The Room, I'm like, ah, there's like a charm. There's like a charm. There's like a haha funny, like, okay, that's why it's a cult flick. I get it. This is just all over the place.
I wonder if there is a fan cut of this, because there are so many fan cuts out there that are...
I think there is a fan cut.
There must be.
Yeah.
If it's good or not, that's for us to find out. But there's so much potential, and I'm so upset that it's not reaching it. I guess
that's probably the saddest part. You're right. Yeah.
I guess we'll see what Denis finds out. That's really what it all ends up with. Like, hopefully, fingers crossed. When it comes to ratings, Mao, I have no idea.
Like, it gets one star.
One star.
One star because I love the production design and I think David Fincher got fucked over. That's it. One star. Maybe half, I'm not gonna lie.
Can you give a movie 0 stars? Because we're kind of basing it on Letterboxd with our 5 stars there.
I think what you can do is not rate it.
Can I not rate it?
Nah. Yeah, like you just write a review and maybe just in there write like 0 stars. This gets no stars for me.
Yeah, but then you don't log it perfectly on the website and all.
I think the least you can give Letterboxd is half a star.
Yeah, that is true. But I feel like it deserves 1 star.
Yeah.
Actually. So 1 star for me too. It's it has potential and the first half of the movie is watchable. Ish. It's okay.
Oh man.
Have we ever seen a movie that is this shitty?
No, because even Shark Boy and Lava Girl had some really
so good.
Good saving qualities.
Well, what a disappointing conclusion to an episode, to a movie talk. I guess you can't always end up on top.
Yeah.
Is there some sort of incentive out of this? I don't know.
Honestly, this movie left me like it was so boring by the end of it, and I was like sad, especially because we've been watching pretty solid movies up to this point.
Yeah,
but like you said, we can't always be on top.
Yeah, I mean it's good to shine light on the good and the bad in a way. Mm-hmm. If anything, it serves as a As we said, it serves as an example for what not to do. Mm-hmm. But with that, my cup of coffee is over. Is yours over?
Yes.
Mine is finito. So let's wrap it up and give some shout outs to our social medias, etc. Boom.
Well, Agat, let me tell you, we are on pretty much every platform that you can listen to podcasts on. We also have a YouTube version of this that we put a lot of work into, so if you could check it out, it'd be nice. Well, like it, share it, comment it. To those of you who have made it this far, thank you so much for joining us in, you know, this very, very depressing ride that was Dune 1984 by David Lynch. We also have Letterboxd. We log as many movies as we watch. Agat's not that good at it, but he's trying. He tries. So join us over there. Hop in on the conversation. We would love to hear your thoughts on the many movies that we get to see throughout the year. Thank you so much for joining us. Agat, it's always a pleasure to Fika with you.
I always sit on Letterboxd and I'm like, oh, fuck, I watched that movie the other day. I have to log it for Mao's sake. So you're with me, at least.
Mm.
And also, thank you, even though you might not have been listening to us from the very beginning, it's now soon officially been a year of podcasting. Impressive that we made it this far.
And yeah, with my commitment issues and your lack of caring, yeah, for sure.
There you go. It's it's something to celebrate, I guess. Next time on Fika and Podcast. I don't even know the title of the show.